Hey everyone, this is the next video in the series about Spring Boot caching. In the last video, I have talked about the Spring Boot project setup and all the theory about caching. In this video, we are going to talk about all the annotations that I have explained to you. I'll use in the project and show you this in action, how they are working. Want to see other videos? These are the three videos I already have uploaded. So in the current project, we are going to use the database connection. Want to know how to interact with the database? This is the playlist that I already have created. You can go ahead with this, and all the source code is coming on this repository. All right, so this is the Spring Boot project that I already have explained, and I have added some endpoints and database interaction also, just to save the time so that we can focus on the caching annotations only, right? So this is the starter cache dependency. It is to download the caching related dependencies. This is starter web to make the application work as a REST application. This is the starter data JPA. This is required to interact with the database. And this is the MySQL database driver, which is used to connect to MySQL database. MySQL server is running on my application, right? I have created this table book, and this has one entry. I already have post one entry. We will play around with this, right? And this is the application, and let me walk you through the code. So this is the project structure. We have API, controller, DTO, and repository. So first, moving to controller, book controller, we have added four endpoints: to add the books, to update the book, to get the book from the database, and to delete the book from the database. All right. So let me walk you through the implementation of this. So we have just have called the service method from the controller only. Okay. All of these methods are defined in book service. Go to book service. Book service is interface which has implementation here. I have written the code for adding the book, for updating the book, for getting the book, as well as deleting the book. All of this is interacting with the repository, book repository. Go ahead and see that. So book repository is extending the JPA repository, which has already methods defined for saving the book, for getting the book, and for deleting the book. To update the book, I have written the custom query right here. To update the book, it is going to update the name of the book if it is matching with the particular ID. All right, so this is the parameters that I am passing, right? So this is about the methods that it is going. So now talk about the caching, that caching annotation should be talked about. So start with the enabling the caching to our application. All right, so to do that, we need one annotation, enable caching. Without this annotation, it is any annotation you use that is not going to work, right? So the caching annotation we are going to use in the service IMPL, right? So first of all, I want to use the caching annotation in the get book while we are getting the book. So first it will talk to database, get the book, and put that in database. So what is the annotation for that? Cacheable is the annotation, right? So give some name to cache. So I want to give it name some books. So caching is key value, right? So if you are not giving any key, it is going to determine that, calculate that key automatically. So, but I want to give it. Let's define the keys. Okay, key attribute is there, so I have to give the key hash ID. So this ID is going to get matched. This is the magic of the Spring expression language that is going to make get things working right here. So key is going to work that. So this is the annotation while getting the book. You want the annotation as well when you are updating the book. So what is the annotation for that? So we have annotation for that cache put, right? So when you have @cache, you see things, all the things coming, cache put. Putting the cache name here, it should be same as you have given for the cacheable, and key also should be same. So here we have we are not directly passing the ID, we are passing the push, we are passing the book. So I have to take out the ID from there. So book dot ID, this is going to get the ID for us. Same thing, cache put, cacheable we have. So you have get the book, and when you are updating the book, so the same thing is going to get updated in the cache also. One more scenario is there when you are deleting some book. So you are not deleting that from the cache, right? So you have to put the cache evict annotation to delete the things from the cache also, right? So delete method is here, put cache evict right here. Put the same configuration here also, cache names, book, name is books, and key is Here I have passed directly ID, so ID is okay. Right. So caching works very well when you are using this in proper combination, right? So when you are getting, updating or deleting, otherwise it is going to backfire on you. Alright, so if you have used the annotation only cacheable annotation, imagine you have used this annotation only or not using the cache port, right? So you are getting the book, so it is stored in the cache. Alright, when you are going to update the book, you are updating the same book in the database but not updating the same in the cache. So when you will call the get book on the same ID, it is going to return the things from the cache. Remember the flow of the cache annotation, how it works. When it is cacheable, it is going to check the cache names with this ID. If it is present there, it has nothing to do in the method what is written there. It is going to return the things from the cache only. If it is not found there, it is going to fetch the data book from the database. Alright, so the same thing applies with the delete also. If you some books are in your cache, but actually you have called the annotation for deleting without using this cache evict annotation. So you are not updating the cache but the database. But that information is in cache. So when you will call this get book, it will return the things from the cache only. Alright. So it is not going to talk to database. So actually it is deleted, but in cache it is there. So you will get that. So there will be misinformation, right? So it caching is very good for performance improvement and cost saving. But it should be used properly along with storing, updating and deleting the cache. Alright, so let's go ahead and we are done here. So we have put all the annotation at right places. So start the application and see this in action. So first important annotation is here enable caching. So you have one place control to enable and disable the caching. So if you want to disable the caching, remove it from here. So no annotation is going to work for that, right? Enable it. So this annotation is pretty much important. So I have the application is running now. Go to Postman. So here is the Postman. So our application is running on port 8001. Okay, so we have book stored with the ID 41. All right, so I'm going to get this book. No, ID is not 41. So ID is 42, all right. So I have to get the book with ID 42, right? Okay, so yeah, let me show you the console. So it is fetching the book from DB. So earlier it was trying with the ID 1, it was not there. So that is why it returned 1, null, fetching book from DB. For ID 42, it has returned the book for us. Now clear the console. And so if I hit this endpoint again, so imagine what will happen. It is going to return the book from the cache, right? So return the book. Now there is no interaction with the database. How we are knowing this? Because in book service IMPL, when getting the book, I have put this log. When if this method is going to execute, this log is going to get printed, right? Because ID 42 is already there in the cache, so that is going to return from there. Now go ahead and use the put annotation, right? So I'm changing this to put and body and mention the body here. So you have raw and here JSON and do some changes here, right? So change the name. So I have written the method to update the name only. So it is going to interact with the ID 42 and going to change the name, right? So hit this again. It had changed the name. So if I come here, book updated with new name, right? So it is updated. So now try to get the book again. So new name I should get, right? So I got the updated detail here, right? And see when you are hitting the get, see the logs. When you are getting the book, it is not interacting with the database, but it is returning from the cache only. Because you have updated by using this annotation cache put, you have updated the database as well as cache also, right? So try it once again. Try to give some name, programming 123, right? So the difference between cache put and cacheable is cache put always executes the method body, right? So and whatever information is there, it is going to update that one. But with the get, it is going to check if it is in cache. It is going to return from there only, but if it is not in cache, it is going to execute the method body. So now the book is programming 123. Go ahead and get this. All right, we got the updated book, right? Now play around with the cache a bit, right? So I have to delete the book. Suppose I deleted this book 42, right? Book deleted, right? So C45, try to get this book again. Yeah, null is returning. So this is the magic of the cache evict, right? So cache evict has done this. So we are done with the cacheable, cache put and cache evict, as well as enable caching, right? So just the homework for you. So you just play around and see the behavior when you are not using all of these annotations, right? And one more thing. So if in any flow, if your method is going to return throw any exception, it is not returning the things properly, it is not going to impact the caching. Suppose if I try to update the book, it is not found in the database and it is throwing some exception. So that cache is not going to get updated at the same time. So caching, as I told you from the starting, caching is very good for performance improvement when it is used properly. If there is any inconsistency in using that, so it is going to create the problem and you will not know from where the problem is coming, right? So it is important to know the intricacies, how it is working and where to use that, right? In the next video, I'm going to talk about customization, how we can do that. And in this video, we are talking about the simple cache manager that Spring Boot itself provides. Okay, so I'll talk about some customization around this, how to set the TTL, eviction policies and all those stuffs, right? And in the future videos, I'll start with the Redis and ES cache also. So all of this code, I'm going to push it in the GitHub repository. You can get the link from the description box. Guys, if you like the content, please don't forget to subscribe and share it with your friends. I'll see you in the next video with the customization and other videos, right? So take care. Bye bye.